Good evening, everyone. It is 7:04. I know it's hard to believe. It is actually the October 2022 meeting of the Village Tivoli Board of Trustees. Would you please rise and join me for the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Village Clerk's report. Clerk Bruno, please.
Yes, in the past month, there were 401 trash tags that were sold. Two payrolls were processed by Treasurer Day. Laura Gale Tyler, Deputy Clerk, continues to assist in the office and also with planning and zoning boards. Friday, November 11th, the office will be closed in observance of Veterans Day.
Thank you. And I'm not sure yet that we'll decide a day before, perhaps based on the weather, but I will be making remarks with the members of the Harris Smith close to the American Legion for Veterans Day. We either do it in inclement weather over here by the American Legion Hall, or good weather will be up on Monument Hill, so do look for that.
Yep.
Trustees, we have in your binders two sets of minutes. We have the October 12th workshop minutes, that was last week, and then we have the September 21st regular meeting minutes, and I will give a special thank you to Clerk Bruno. There was a lot of public comment to capture from last month, and we did a great job. These are several pages longer than sometimes, so thank you for that. And also, my remarks, my little speech I made right before we voted on the police contract is included in here for contemporary and posterity, so thank you, Clerk Bruno. Is there a motion to accept both sets of minutes?
No move.
Second?
Second.
Baldino, any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
The Treasurer's report. In September, out of the general fund, $55,879.59. Out of the capital fund, $14,675.21. For a grand total of $70,554.80. Is there a motion to accept the Treasurer's report?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Is there a motion to pay the bills?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion?
No.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Moving on to a zoning report, Trustee Ezrati, please.
Yes. I did take a look at this. I know it's here. No. Our zoning enforcement officer reviewed and issued three building permits this month. He investigated and received one complaint. He issued two property maintenance violations, but no appearance tickets. He undertook one municipal search and eight inspections and continues to provide code enforcement training by his companies, these three. No fire inspections.
Thank you, Trustee Ezrati. And on behalf of the village, I traveled all the way to Pauling last week for the grand opening of Z3's new facility. They actually took a burned out restaurant and gutted it and fixed it up, and that's their new offices now. So it was a nice little evening to see, to understand how far they drive to come up here, among other things. We will now entertain public comment on agenda items only, and I'm sorry I was remiss not to mention a little earlier, we have an additional agenda item. It's not on your agenda. This is authorizing a, we have to speak over the pipes in Village Hall here. This is authorizing a change order for the CHIPS paving project, which is currently underway. We have identified a collapsed pipe and a driveway apron which need extra work. So this agenda item is authorizing a change order with the contract for TJR for $26,500, so to speak. So with that, is there any public comment on our three agenda items? Okay, we're gonna move right into it. And the first thing we have Presentation from the Dutchess County Human Rights Commission and our old Tivoli friend, Jen Drake. So would you like to approach the board or stand maybe over there? Wherever you're most comfortable.
Would you like a podium?
No, that's okay. Two of us.
Thank you for coming.
Hi there, thanks for having us. So I'm Jen Drake, and this is my colleague Doris Diaz Kelly. We're two of the 14 volunteer commissioners who serve on the Dutchess County Commission on Human Rights. And we want to tell you just a little bit about what the commission is, what it does, and how we can be a resource to the village and its residents. So Doris is going to start, and then I'll talk more.
So thank you for having us.
Pleasure.
To be in person, too.
Yes.
I'm easing in into all of these in-person pleasures. So as we know, it's been a moment in history, in time, or maybe more than a moment, 2 years or so, where our country has faced a lot of adversity and different challenges, and within those are an increase of hate and bias crimes throughout the communities. So our goal has been to talk about the work that the commission does throughout the municipalities in Dutchess County. And we've been doing that for the past 2 years or so and making our way through. So we're finally in Tivoli, and we want to introduce us, our work, and how we can help communities and how we can establish a collaboration. And hopefully we will work together in the months to come. So a little bit about us. The Dutchess County Human Rights Commission was established in 1984, and after a slight pause, it was then re-established in 2016 by the county executive. And the commission is comprised of 14 members, volunteer members, of which Jen and I are two, as well as our leader, Jody Miller. She's the commission chair and the county employee. The commission members are appointed by the county executive and or the chairman of the Dutchess County Legislature. We serve 3 years and the possibility of reappointment. We welcome applications from the community. It's on a rolling basis. It's on the website, submit it, and we will be glad to welcome. We're hoping to represent the county throughout the entire county. So we're looking for different municipalities to join the commission. What is our mission? Our mission is to defend human rights, bridging differences, and embracing diversity. By way of resolution and county local law, our purpose and our role is to foster mutual respect and understanding amongst all racial, religious, and ethnic groups. To educate the county's communities on the issues affecting human rights, to address discriminatory practices as well as tension and conflict, and to help resolve them with the community, to organize and participate in community activities, events, and to build goodwill, to develop programs that speak to the issues and concerns of the community, and to act as a bridge, not necessarily to solve ourselves to solve, but to help the community with our resources solve the issues that are important to the community. The commission is not an investigative body, so it does not investigate. Other areas do have that, but we do not. We are not an enforcement authority. We are a resource for the community to help assist with concerns and issues.
If anyone has a specific concern about their own human rights having been violated or someone near them, the best thing to do is to reach out to our commissioner, Jody Miller, who can talk you through the process. Typically, a complaint can be filed with the New York State Division of Human Rights, and that is where the complaints actually are investigated and action happens. But Jody is really the person who can answer questions about very specific issues, and those are around like the protected classes, things like age, disability. You know, people can't be discriminated based upon a whole list of protected classes. So I'm going to talk just a little bit about the commission, what we've actually done around the county. So we've done a handful of educational events and programs. We did something here in Tivoli in this lovely administrative room in honor of your illustrious former resident Eleanor Roosevelt and her birthday, which is last week,
next week, 12th.
right around now, so Tivoli has
last week.
Yes. So we try to, you know, bring education about the topic of human rights around the county. We, during COVID, we were originally planning to do a regional conference on human, on actually on the issue of hate and the rise of hate bias, hate and bias incidents. Of course, COVID prevented that. So we did a Zoom speaker series instead, which was actually very well attended. So we continue to work with our partners in Orange County and Ulster County to do things like that. We've hosted bystander intervention trainings, which help to give residents of the county the tools to intervene if they see a bias incident or a discriminatory incident kind of playing out. We've also, we were quite involved in the police reform and modernization, sort of, if the, those, movement might be a strong word, but the process. So we hosted and facilitated public discussions where people had a chance to put their input in around police reform and what needed to change. We've also, we try to do a lot of what we try to focus on is around just fostering mutual understanding. You know, I think at this moment in time, our communities are pretty divided, and so sometimes just bringing people together for conversation has a lot of value. So we had a series of sessions called 100 Cups of Coffee, where people come together and just sit with someone who they don't know and have a sort of structured conversation. And out of that, in Poughkeepsie, something very tangible that came out of that, residents in Poughkeepsie talked about how they were afraid to walk through certain neighborhoods because they were really dark. And so one of the nonprofits in Poughkeepsie helped people fix their porch lights and distributed LED light bulbs so that there could be more porch lights in Poughkeepsie and people could feel more safe walking around the neighborhood. So there some really tangible things can come out of these. We've also held listening sessions around the county where we just get people together and just talk about the issues in human rights and hear from residents. Through those, we've heard about anti-Semitic events that signs that were put up that were really troubling. And we've had some opportunity to intervene and do some healing around some of those issues. And then when particular issues come up, there was an issue at a school district in the southern part of the county where a young woman of Muslim descent was being discriminated against, and there was some bias sort of action that was happening with her classmates. And the school was really doing their best, but didn't really have the tools to actually address the issue in a satisfactory way. So the commission was able to get involved and, you know, in a sort of, again, sort of a way of fostering of mutual understanding, kind of a way, able to kind of really move the school towards a place of addressing the issue in a thoughtful, respectful way that just kind of made everybody feel better about what was happening. So those are some of the things we've been doing. Again, if there's ever a concern, if something comes up in the community, I encourage you to get in touch, talk to Jody Miller. She's our commissioner. She's absolutely wonderful. And she's really, really great at thinking through and working with communities and individuals on what would you like to happen? What has happened? How can we help? And what would you like the resolution to be? And then we can work on those issues.
So as you've heard Jen mention, we can be a resource in many ways, and we look forward to that. We're hoping that if anything arises, you now know that there is a group of people, a resource that you can call upon. Many times we hear from community members that they were not aware that someone can help with said issue, and even just to discuss it and put it out there. The ask that we have of you is to designate, assign a liaison with the commission. So someone from the board to be a liaison, and we look forward to that, and we'll have time to talk about that down the road. We thank you for your time. We thank you for hearing us, and if there are any questions, we're more than willing to answer.
So you said there are 14 people at the commission?
That's right, 14 volunteers, and we serve on sort of rolling three-year terms, some appointed by the county legislature, some appointed by the county executive. Basically, we have a nominating committee on the commission that looks at resumes and applications for those who want to be members, and then we make recommendations, and those are either approved or not by the county. But we do hope, you know, we try to have in that 14, we try to have representatives from, you know, different ages, different races, different genders, different parts of the county. We really want to try to be representative of the whole county. So if you know anyone in Tivoli who would like to throw their hat into the ring if they were always looking for.
And what sort of qualifications or background is, you know, attractive to you all in terms of saying this person is, you know, we should try and get them on the commission?
Really, I think time and energy. But Doris, you've been on the nominating committee, so you can probably speak more to that.
Time and energy, just come with an open heart and open mind to, you know, dig in the work. Everyone, we're all from different backgrounds. I'm in education, and I've been in education forever. But we just finished our intake, or new membership, and we have a very good representation. You know, the time has lent itself a lot of interest in the commission's work.
Mm-hmm. Like any board, you need some time and some, you know, some willingness to kind of roll up your sleeves. And
sure.
But other than that, no particular expertise is necessary.
Okay. Good to know. Cool. Well, we will look amongst ourselves for a liaison for sure. And
we'll reach back out.
Thank you.
Any questions from the public for the Human Rights Commission? Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
Moving on through our agenda, we have the approval of a renewal of the MVP health insurance. The village offers health insurance to members of our staff who are full-time. I want to thank Trustee Azrati for sort of looking this over. It's not the worst increase we've seen. It is an increase. And looking amongst the trying to ramble so that Trustee Andrew can get in here and vote on this. So we are again going to go with the MVP renewal plan, the Silver 3. And this year's increase is 5% on that, which is less than other plans. So we've been on the same plan for a number of years now. Is there a motion to approve renewal of the MVP health insurance?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. And now we have that last minute agenda item authorizing a change order in the contract with TJR. So our initial contract was $158,250 for all the paving going on around the village. They're milling currently throughout the development. They'll be over on North Road next week. They've already been on Spring Street. These two change orders are $8,000 for the replacement of a concrete driveway apron and change order number two for $18,500 for the replacement of a damaged drain pipe on North Road. Those are the two change orders. And just for the benefit of the public, we're getting ready to get over there on North Road, and we discovered that a large pipe that takes catch basins from the east side goes diagonally under North Road to the, from the west side over to the east side, and then all the way through the stormwater system, ultimately exiting under the bridge into the creek. That pipe is completely collapsed and blocked. So rather than pave the road and then make that repair, we'd like to make that repair and then pave the road. And the driveway apron is on the east side of the street where the granite curbing and this apron have sunk so low that if we don't raise it up, we won't have the altitude to then create sufficient pitch to get the water to go to the adjacent catch basins. So to prevent future puddling, which damages the road, we need to lift that up and create the pitch. With that explanation, trustees, is there a motion to authorize the change order for TJR?
Ooh, I move.
Is there a second?
Second.
That was Deputy Mayor, followed by Trustee Baldino. Do a roll call, please. Deputy Mayor Major?
Aye.
Trustee Baldino?
Aye.
Trustee Azrati?
Aye.
And Trustee Mangieri?
Aye.
Thank you very much. I also want to thank our engineer, Crawford, for acting very swiftly on the time between when we found the pipe was clogged and getting this proposal and recommendation. It was a matter of hours, so I appreciate working with them as always. The next board meeting will be held Wednesday, November 16th, 2022 at 7 o'clock here in the historic Watts DePeyster Hall, preceded by a workshop at 6 p.m. And we have our regular workshop on November 9th, 2022 at 7 p.m. And While we're on dates, I'm just going to go ahead and announce that the Village Board is going to be holding a community forum on Tuesday, November 1st at 7 p.m. right here in this room on the topic of short-term rentals. So this is things like Airbnb, Vrbo, bed and breakfasts, any version of short-term rental. Short-term rental is defined as 30 days or less. So this is really what you're thinking about in terms of, you know, Airbnb and Vrbo. We, among the board, the Zoning Review Committee worked on this for many, many months, kind of before the pandemic. Things got slowed down, they stopped meeting for a while. They brushed off the recommendations. Those came to us in August, and we've been talking about it now for 2 months. Short-term rentals are currently not permitted in the village.
That doesn't mean they aren't here.
Now, we are aware, as anyone who picks up their phone, that there are a number occurring in the village currently, and I want those people to understand that that is not permitted. And we are going to be having this forum at which the board is going to give a lot of information and terminology to the public so we can have a good conversation about this. Defining a short-term rental as less than 30 days. Hosted, somebody is on premise. Unhosted, nobody's on premise. That sort of stuff. And also, we are very eager to hear from the members of this community as to what they think the rules should be. So it's just as much for us to take the pulse of residents here and what you want to see in your village as for us to sort of share with you the buckets of concerns that the ZRC came up with and that we've come up with, things like hosted, unhosted, should it just be in certain districts of the village or village-wide, for example. So
inspections, all kinds of
yes.
Things.
So again, Tuesday, November 1st, community forum on short-term rentals, 7 o'clock right here. It's very much a conversation. There are no decisions being made that night, but the more people participate in the conversation, the better whatever the village decides to do will be, I'm sure. So please, I'll be announcing this in an email blast tomorrow. I'm sure it'll be up on social media, and we hope to see many of you there on November 1st. Okay, moving into trustee reports. Trustee Ezrati. All right. Everything's good in LoSAP?
Yes.
Okay.
Tickety-boo.
Tickety-boo. Trustee Baldino?
I'm going to read the Justice Court report for this month.
Thank you.
We have had $355 in fines, $279 in surcharges, zero in civil fees, for a total of $634. And just for record, we had only four tickets on here, and half of them are for speeding. So we talked about that in the past, and it comes up a lot in our meetings. And they're not speeding slowly, they're speeding very fast. And this means down a street like Montgomery going 46 miles an hour and 70 miles an hour. 76 and 55, sorry. So that's probably, I don't know where there's a 55 actually here. Where's the 55?
Not 9G anymore.
Not 9G. Well, that's still pretty fast.
Yeah.
So please slow down.
Yeah, thank you, Trustee Baldino. Trustee Mangieri?
Nothing too much to report other than that the Story Horse Theater was excellent. I enjoyed it immensely. I wish there could be more. Maybe I'll be in the next one.
Right.
My friend said like on the Facebook that she said, oh, you know, that Emily was my first friend from a few years ago, but the few years was 36. So I was like, well, maybe it'll be in the next one, 36 years or so. But it was really wonderful. It was a wonderful performance. It was nice to see the community come together to, you know, hear the story of their family and their history. And I learned a lot about my neighbors who I already knew, but I didn't know so much detail. And it was nice. It was really nice. I had a good feeling. I had all the feels that night.
Yeah, it, definitely. Thank you and congratulations to Jeremy Greenberg and Mary Stewart Masterson, Story Horse Theater, who put that together. It was sort of under the larger umbrella of the sesquicentennial, which has been going on all year. Back in February, when he said I might do some sort of theater piece, we had no idea that it was going to turn into that. So
and just it was wonderful. A fundraiser for the fire department.
And it was a fundraiser for the firehouse expansion. So good all the way around.
I also actually want to read this.
I get to read that one.
Oh, sorry. Sure.
I see. Maybe next month. I'll give it to you next month. You know, the other thing that struck me so much in the Village Kind was, for me, if a mother called me up and said, "Hey, Mayor, can I send my children across town to disassemble an abandoned building and carry all the pieces back across the village and reassemble it?" And the mayor just said yes, and it was fine. I mean, that is so impossible to even conceive of in 2022 with liability and whatnot. It's just, I thought, wow.
Right, but who is going to say no to a woman with 16 children?
It was a remarkable story. Okay, so the report that I'm coveting sharing this week is our first report from the Red Hook Police Department. They came in with us in the second half of September. This report just covers the first 2 weeks that they were here in the village. There were 20 incidents. I'll go back over what these things mean. There were 23 uniform traffic tickets issued. So that includes speeding, stop signs, and illegal U-turns. You know, when people come up in the main intersection and whip all the way around, there have been a number of those tickets written. There were 5 parking tickets, and most of those were this strange backwards parking phenomenon. It seems to have, I don't see quite as much of it since Red Hook's been here, but I did see 2 cars last weekend who were doing that. So you have to park with traffic. And there were 2 arrests. Now, an arrest in their report is not necessarily cuffed and taken away in a car. An arrest is when you're issued a ticket, for example, an open container. And I happen to know that these 2 arrests were both open container tickets. So, and incidents, 20, that is, you know, things that they had to check out where there was no ticket issued. So I want to remind residents that if you have need of police for any reason, the number is 845-758-0060. For the last few years, we've been instructing residents to call the Dutchess County Sheriff's Office. It is no longer our first phone number to go to. It's Red Hook PD. They're 10 minutes away, and the number is 758-0060. So I know the ticket writing has proceeded apace in the early months of October, and next month I will share and let you read that one, okay? And I'll tell you, it's the vast majority is speeding tickets. It's just crazy how much speeding has been going on, and I, for one, am glad that we're getting some enforcement on that. It's been a perennial complaint from residents, as it should be. So. Very appreciative of what the Red Hook PD has been doing in their first month with us. Other things, let's see. Well, let's go over to Deputy Mayor Major, and then I'll come back.
All right, I'm going to keep it super Halloween-y. If you have not yet, check out historicredhook.org. They have a cemetery crawl going on, which a lot of work went into researching various dead people. And so you go to the different cemeteries. First go to the Historic Red Hook, get the information, and then go to the various cemeteries throughout the town and go and find, for example, I think today the post was about somebody near. And you know, just giving his history and what the iconography of his gravestone talks about, and you know, just sort of his life story. So that's lots of fun and a great chance to explore the cemeteries. Also, take a picnic, because in the Victorian era, cemeteries were planned out as parks and a nice quiet place to go, spend a little time in nature. So enjoy. The library has a ton of stuff going on. Check out on their Facebook page or at the website, thelibrary.org. Tilly, I'm sorry, tillyfreelibrary.org. There's an event
creating spooky cookie houses. There's an event, a couple of events for spooky stories, and there's something called Mummy Madness, which could be a lot of things. And Claremont State Historic Site is doing their annual Legends by Candlelight, which is sort of a ghost tour. It's pretty fun. And the mansion just got an outside, got the exterior spruced up with a pretty extensive project, so that'd be cool to see. So this weekend and next, $12 for adults, $5 for kids. Get out in the bays, it's amazing. The colors out there are just spectacular. And the ticks are out of control. Like, they are just feasting for winter. So wear your safety orange and check yourself afterwards. Have a great time.
And on Halloween, our favorite village across town, Village Red Hook, is having a full participation Halloween costume parade on Saturday the 29th at 1 o'clock. And they're encouraging, obviously, costumes and also human-powered floats. So if you whip something up on your radio flyer wagon and want to pull that through the parade or on your tricycle or whatever else, the more the merrier. So just wanted to plug that for our friends over in Red Hook and Mayor Smythe. I know the Tivoli Library will be there in costume, and we'll see. So, thank you, Deputy Mayor. So I just want to recap. Short-term rental community forum, November 1st. And the milling, just talking about the paving project that's underway, we're sort of in the middle of it. They've been milling up the roads, the areas that we're fixing in the development. That'll continue this week. I don't think we have more rain in the week. Next week, things are, weather permitting, everything's going to move over to North Road. Monday through Friday, the 24th through 28th, people should expect no parking, interruptions, closures. There may be moments when the road is open. There will be many moments when it's totally closed. So we'll be getting a lot of signage up about that. And I'll try and communicate through village emails, but just expect North Road between Broadway and Pine Street. Plan alternative routes, for sure. And with that, just a little teaser. I think we have a tentative date for Winterfest. December 3rd? Okay. So more on that coming up. We've got to get through Halloween first and Thanksgiving. All right, with that, I'd like to open the floor for public comment on any topic. Yes, Jeanette.
I'd like to add to Emily's report about activities for Halloween. The Tivoli Library is participating in the Red Hook Parade in the afternoon, but in the evening there is a local Tivoli party at the VFW here.
Okay, at the American Legion, and what time will that be?
I think it's the 7.
7?
Great.
Okay. Thank you very much, Jeanette.
Also, I would like to ask about safety issues in the park. First of all, the lamp that is by the pavilion, between the pavilion and the basketball court, is doing this off-on kind of thing.
Okay.
And we old ladies who are active at night and come through the park have to stop and wait until the light comes on.
Okay.
So that we can see.
Sure.
And the other night I couldn't see the asphalt and I kind of fell into the grass. But that's in here or there. Also, I wanted to ask about security around the restrooms. I understood there were supposed to be cameras, but I haven't seen any.
Mm-hmm.
And it would feel really good to know that there were some there.
Yes.
I'm coming through here at night.
Sure. Thanks for letting us know about the lamp. On lamps, there have been a number that were out around the village. We finally, thank you, Brian, we finally have a pretty good contact at Central Hudson, and every pole has a number on it. It's usually a 6-digit number. And if you email that to me, I email it to Brian Finn over there, and some of them, he's been fixing them pretty quick. So we fixed two more this week, Spring Street and over here. So like tomorrow, for example, I'll go get the number off of that pole and let them know. So that's helpful. You know, we need the streetlights working, obviously, for all sorts of reasons. There is a camera over there trained on the bathrooms, and we're doing some maintenance on it right now, but we will absolutely get that working. Unfortunately, we have again had a lot of vandalism in the bathroom, which is infuriating. I mean, we just fixed doorknobs, they smashed the doorknobs, graffiti inside, whatnot. We passed our inspection for the summer camp back in August by making a number of repairs, and some of those were the very things that have been destroyed last week. So we do need that camera operating over there. So thanks for bringing it up.
That would feel good. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Other public comment?
Yes. On the lamps, actually, is there a way to have it not be LEDs? Personally, I mean, if you look out back there, there's a street lamp right behind the building with an LED, and then there's one further back with like a sodium halogen type. The sodium's much nicer. I mean, I'm sure Central Hudson may have thoughts, but just in terms of character, I think it's sort of indisputable that it's a much nicer type of light.
Yeah, personally, I agree with you. They are going away, and it's all LEDs. Those have been being replaced. I mean, I remember when the whole village was those, and it is a nicer light. We were able to get them to not put in the most ugly LED that they have, and put in the second, you know.
Second list.
But
no,
yeah,
we argued the historic character, and you're trying to get a lower Kelvin scale, right? Yeah, lower light. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you still can't get something like a black body radiation type situation out of an LED anyway, so.
Yeah, Central Hudson is quite committed to their LEDs, and that's what is coming.
Yeah.
Further public comment?
If I might be allowed, I'd like to present each of the board members with a synopsis of the events that I've been experiencing for several years now.
Mr. John Collins.
Along with some pictures to support and maybe some brief history. One copy for each and just the pictures. Beginning in 2017, I began initiating contact with the village. Just a little bit of a background. I have a neighbor who has two properties on the side of our property, and he's done extensive work on both, and the water infiltration into our property at some set point in time has been almost unbearable. Not unbearable, but it makes it very difficult to get in and work in the backyard. And I contend that both of the water collection basins he's put in just aren't adequate, plus other things. In 2017, I attempted to get the village to act before he put in the water basin on what I'm going to refer to, and I have referred to here, as the rental property, knowing that we had already been experiencing issues because of the collection basin he had on the owner property, as well as the other additions on the owner property. The village did not act before that was put in. In November of that year, the village and the village engineer, I was advised via email from the mayor, the village engineer said that additional collection would have to be installed on that property. The village did not follow up on that pledge, and no additional storage was ever put in. And I've highlighted four items, and I'm not going to go through the entire four pages. You can read it on your own. In September of 2019, a couple years later, and this is not a complete list of the emails and communications. This would have gone on much longer. And most of these communications were accompanied with pictures, like some of the pictures I've shown you here. In September of 2019, I advised the code enforcement officer at that point in time that there was additional construction being undertaken to the main structure, and requesting whether or not a building permit had been prepared. He eventually replied that a building permit had been issued for that, and based upon what we know at this point in time, likely in violation of the village's code for lot coverage of 35%. Whether or not that was the case or not, but all the other structures and items on the property were in place when that addition was put in, and when the prior enforcement officer said that a building permit had been issued. This is the one that really I cannot answer, and nobody's been able to answer. In November of that same year, the village's engineer provided me with a letter stating that they had visited the site and that the water collection basin on the rental property was working as designed. They did not see any standing water. They did not see any excess moisture in the ground. Now, I've given you two pictures that were taken just about the same time that I got the letter from the engineer's office of that collection basin. And I would question anyone to look me in the eyes and tell me that that collection basin is working as designed with the amount of water that is just sitting there on the ground at that point in time. I have never disputed the fact that our property has been wet at times over the year, but we've never had standing water all the time. One of the pictures I gave you is our backyard, which is a frequent occurrence of the standing water in our backyard because of what's occurred with the property owner and the village's delays and inabilities to deal with this. And then the final one would be the very last one is this year I've been asking since the spring for copies of the calculations about lot coverage. Nothing has been provided until just recently. And the lot coverage that was provided to me by the current zoning enforcement officer did not complete an entire review of that property. They only focused on what I provided as items in an estimate, but they did not do a complete review. And Mr. Mayor, in your last email to me, you said you could not guarantee that anything not in the lot coverage provided to me by the code enforcement officer would be included in the base calculation for the lot coverage. And to me, the village has a responsibility to do a complete survey, and lot coverage should be based on what's there at this point in time, based on a complete survey. And I'm sorry I have to be like this, but I don't believe that the village has been acting in our interest for 5 years. And I know it's a difficult situation. My neighbor has done a lot of nice work with his property. I don't hold that grudge anymore, but his work can't affect others. The other picture I showed you, our neighbors just to the south. And the water there, it's just there's no place for the water to go there. And especially with the additional coverage and two undersized water collection basins that routinely overflow. And again, like I said, multiple pictures of both basins have been provided to the village. The engineering report in 2019, I wrote a letter, as you know, but one of those pictures was part of that letter, requesting to sit down to show me and explain to me how they could possibly come to that conclusion. And that's never occurred. So I don't know where else to go and what to do at this point in time, Mr. Mayor. Right now, I can't even get my backyard to mow or pick up the lawn pick up the leaves right now because of the heavy rains last week. So I'm beside myself. I don't know what else to do here or how to get your attention. Something's got to be done. And if I was him, I'd be upset too. In the fact that the village apparently gave him a permit, if that is so, that did happen in 2019. And now they're saying that he's over, but we can't use our property a lot of the time because of the rain. And you've got the synopsis, you can read it, and that's all I can say.
thank you, Mr. Collins. You do have and have had my attention, sir. I can't tell you that's not the case. I mean, I understand your frustration, and I respect your right to say that, but I'm just telling you, you have my attention. As far as the thing you referenced earlier about, like, I couldn't guarantee what's in the scope of the calculations, right? And you and I have been emailing about that in the last few days. It's the building department, it's the code enforcement officer. The mayor does not go out with a tape measure and do these calculations, you know, himself. It's not in my job, nor do I issue violations or any of that stuff. So insofar as the building department is under my supervision and my responsibility, I am involved and I have been doing what I feel I can do within my role to get my staff and employees to do their job. But the reason I can't answer that question at this time is because I'm not the one who makes the determination what's included in the scope of the elements contributing to lot coverage. So
the question wasn't about what would qualify, I just said, was it even considered? And as I noted in one of my notes, a very substantial addition that was not even considered in the code enforcement officer's calculations was a concrete wall that's at least a foot wide the entire length of the property along that roadway, except for the driveway. And what else wasn't covered? I advised the inspector that there was some other activity going on, as I know in my email.
Right.
What is that activity? I can't tell that from where I am. So all I'm expecting is for the village to complete a complete survey of the property and not just focus on the items that I was able to give approximate estimate just to get to the point that I could demonstrate to the village
right.
that I thought it was over 35%.
Right.
That's all I'm
asking. A couple things. Number one, the village is obligated and I'm committed to that property owner has to be at 35%, or we're never done. So that's just the goal, and I share it as well, because that's our responsibility to every property owner in the district that has a 35% lot coverage. A violation has been issued because he's over. It's going to court. Now, you and my building inspector are in a discussion about, through me, how much is he over? And that conversation isn't finished or settled yet based on, you know, your concern that the measurements didn't include everything that they ought to. But there is a violation written and they're going to court. And so some of it is in motion. The details, you know, if you're, it's like you're in the principal's office because you shot a spitball. Was it three spitballs or one spitball? And we can argue about that, and that's an important conversation, but there was a spitball and you're in the principal's office now. So that's where things are. I, for one, appreciate you bringing this to the full board. It's been challenging for me to, I try and be responsive to every citizen of this village, and I do care, even if it may feel otherwise at times. But in my role as mayor, I'm not able to do some things directly. So I'm in a bit of a, with my building department. Well, that's how things are for the mayor of the village. That's fine, but you know, there are times when I'm communicating with you and he is or isn't part of the conversation. And that's, we have to be careful with that because it's gotta come from him. He's the one with the authority to make the measurements and issue violations. So I can manage him from where I am, but it's not, he's the one. But we have this. I've talked to him today about your situation, and you know, I'm committed to getting it to 35%. I'm sorry, it's gone on a long time for you, and I'm very sorry about your frustration.
Again, 35% obviously depends on the starting point.
Yes, it does. So, you know, it does. Right now, yourself and the building inspector believe he's over. How much over is still the issue, but you know, all parties believe he's over. So we'll see what he removes when he goes to court. And then anyone who's also has the option of going to the Zoning Board of Appeals and asking for, you know, please let me exceed my lot coverage. I doubt they're gonna hand those out, but that's part of the, it's one of the options available to your neighbor there.
Okay. Just one other topic then, to switch topics, and it goes along kind of with just short-term rentals, but it really isn't the same thing, is the issue of what certainly appear to be college rentals within the single-family homes and subdivision, and multiple people, not just individuals in homes.
I'm sorry, I didn't follow. What's
college rentals within the subdivision. Mm-hmm. Rentals within the subdivision, we rented to college students. Is that allowed within the current zoning codes or not, or should it just be individual?
Oh yeah, a rental's a rental. It doesn't matter if you're in college or not in college, or old, young, or green, purple.
And you can have more than, you can have multiple people of different family, not, are not family members?
Yeah, you can. So now, what they can do is exceed, if there's three bedrooms, then there shouldn't be 10 people. So, you know, there's the, every CO says how many people there should be in that house, but, you know, a long-term rental is a legal use anywhere in the village, and you know, the fact that they're college students or not is irrelevant. So, any other public comments on any topic? Anything from the board?
I gotta go.
Okay, that motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Okay, moved by Mangieri, seconded Baldino. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. 7:54, we are adjourned. Have a good evening, everyone.